In this video, I'm going to talk about inspecting the drill block. I'll put a drawing on the screen here. So the first question you usually have when you go to inspect a hole part is where to start. There's a whole lot of information that has to be inspected on this part. A lot of GD&T, a lot of feature control frames to take a look at. My opinion is that when you're inspecting a part with GD&T on it, is that you need to inspect the datums first. And that way you can qualify the datum reference frame. The reason is that if you go ahead and inspect all the position and profile tolerances and things that locate features from datums, then you go and inspect the datums and the datums are bad, you go send the datums out to get reworked. Now all your positions are gonna be off. So say your perpendicularity is off by 30 thousandths, you have to send that surface out to get re-machined to bring it into tolerance, it's gonna move all your positions and profiles. But you wanna get those datums locked in first so that if there is rework, you can do that before you waste a bunch of time inspecting the positions that always come from your datums. Now, on this part, we have three datums. Now, the way we know which one's primary, secondary, and tertiary is by looking at the feature control frames. There's only one datum reference frame on this part. It's A, B, C. You can see it in the several positions and the profile on this drawing. So all of the measurements are going to come from the same place. Now that's not always the case, but it's the case in this part. So we're going to inspect the datums in that order. We'll inspect the primary, secondary, then tertiary. Okay, so when we see the primary datum on this drawing, it's A, it's a flat surface. If you notice, there's no feature control frame attached to it. The reason is that those two surfaces are considered a stock feature. So it should be left as is from, you know, the storeroom. It's cold rolled steel. They have their own tolerances for cold roll. It's generally pretty tight tolerances, you know, within a thousandths or a couple thousandths. So this stock designation basically says don't machine it. So the inspection for that stock dimension is just to look at it and make sure it hasn't been machined, okay? Next up is datum B. This is a perpendicularity to datum A. So essentially, and I've marked it, on our part down here, this is datum B. We want to make sure it's perpendicular to datum A. The way we're going to do that, we'll use a precision angle block. I'm going to set datum A against the angle block. Now, there's two ways to do it. There's probably more than two, but two I can think of, right? We can either clamp it to here, and then indicate the surface in, so we get a zero here, and then sweep it. Or we can take a chance that these two surfaces are parallel and just drop it onto here, as long as we've got 3 points of contact from datum A to this surface. So I'm gonna go ahead and do that. I'll clamp the part so I don't have to hold it. Now to check datum B, I do not need to read this number up here on the height gauge. It does not matter at all, right? There's no location involved with this number. So I'm just gonna lower it down until I get a zero on my indicator. And then I'm gonna sweep the surface, okay? And I'm gonna check my indicator as I'm sweeping. That surface is good to within about 1 thousandths, maybe 2 thousandths, okay? So that's all there is to qualify that datum and that feature control frame. Now, I'll remove this. We need to check datum C, which is perpendicular to datums A and B. So the check will be a little bit different. I'm gonna flip my angle plate over. I'm still gonna get 3 points of contact with A, but now I'm gonna push it up against B like so, okay? Now at this point, I could let it sit on the table and hope that this is good to go, because That is just controlling and translation, right? It doesn't matter if the part is up here or down here, as long as it's touching against datum A and B, translation doesn't matter for the perpendicularity. It would matter if we were locating the surface, but we're not, it's just orientation. So what I'll do is make sure I'm locked in there nice and tight. I'll grab a clamp so it stays still for me. Okay, and same idea, I'm gonna bring my indicator over. I'll lower it until I hit zero, and I'm gonna sweep. So again, we're good to within about a thousandths. So that datum is fully qualified, no problem at all. Let's take a look at the profile that is between noted limits. So between noted limits just indicates on the drawing where the profile goes to. So in this case, it's gonna go from note F to note G. So this is essentially just all of the portions of the part that aren't covered by datums, right? On the outside of the part. So with the profile, now we are locating. So we're gonna need to use the actual numbers on the height gauge to give us the location of that surface. So I'm gonna pick the short side here, opposite of datum C to check first. So how we're gonna do this, I'll flip my angle plate over. We'll get 3 points of contact on A, 2 points on B, and 1 point on C. So that's fully locked in the datum reference frame. I'll clamp the part. Again, this clamp has very little pressure, okay? It's got just enough to hold it tight, but not so much that it's forcing the part into some odd position. Now, I'll bring my indicator down all the way to the table. Oh, I'm trying not to run into anything. I'm gonna zero the indicator, and then I'm gonna zero my height gauge here, okay? And then make sure you turn the wheel in the right direction. If you turn the wheel back toward the table, you're gonna knock it off of zero. So while I'm here, let me show you what I mean. Okay, so say I get zero here, and I accidentally move it the wrong way, right? Happened real fast, but moved it the wrong way. Now, when I go to re-zero it, the height gauge is 70 thousandths off. You don't want that to happen. So if you do accidentally move it down, you gotta re-zero the height gauge. So let me fix this, okay. So now we can bring our workpiece back in. Bring this up, I'm gonna zero the indicator. And I'm gonna read off of our height gauge. Our height gauge reads 3.0105. I could go ahead and tell you this profile is not within tolerance, okay? So a profile of 10 thousandths essentially means you have 5 thousandths on either side of the true profile. So when we bring our indicator up and we zero it, and this is reading 10 thousandths off, we know it's no good. Another way to think about it, if I adjust this so that our height gauge reads exactly 3 inches, right? Now our indicator is off by 10 and a half thousandths, right? So same thing, either way you wanna look at it, either way the part is no good. Now I could sweep the whole surface. Maybe this side's a little bit better. Maybe this side's just a little bit worse. When I go to report the profile, I'm gonna report the worst reading I get, okay? So if it's 12 thousandths off in the, you know, Y direction, that's what I'd put on the paper. You typically don't report the basic dimension. It doesn't really matter, okay? With profile, you're not inspecting basic dimensions, you're inspecting the profile. So it's a little weird when you put it on the inspection form, but these two surfaces we're checking for profile could really be inspected as one. Either the profile passes or it doesn't pass. So let me check the other side since we're here. So we're gonna check the side opposite of B. Now, The setup is about the same. So I flip the angle plate over, 3 points on A, 2 points on B. C, we don't really have to lock in because it's only controlling translation. Our reading up here is gonna be the same no matter where the part is in this direction. So I'm cool with that. I'm gonna go ahead and clamp it. Now, we gotta get a zero because it's profiled, it's read datum, so we are locating a surface. I'm gonna zero off of my angle plate this time because that's where we're measuring from. I'm gonna get a zero. Zero out my indicator, and I just went down accidentally. Now I'll come back up to the surface. So now my indicator reads zero. I've got 1.9995. I would say, as of now, this portion of the profile is gonna be good. Now we could look at it a different way. Now our height gauge is reading 2 inches exactly. We're very, very close within about a thousandths. So this side passed. Now, if you're gonna send this back for rework, on your inspection sheet, you probably want to separate the profile and indicate which side was good, which side was bad. If you just put on your inspection sheet, hey, the profile's out by 12 thousandths, and they go to rework it, they might shave 12 off of both surfaces when you really only need it off of one. So kind of a judgment call thing. Let's chat about inspecting threads. So on this sheet, we've got a 3816 UNC 2B with 21 in parentheses. That 21 comes from the thread standard, I think B1.3. There's three thread gauging standards, so 21, 22, and 23. 21 just indicates that it's a functional check, go, no, go gauge and a visual inspection. It's the quickest way to check a thread, and for almost everything, it's all you need. Either the thread accepts a standard thread or it doesn't. The way we check the actual thread to make sure it's within tolerance is with a go, no go gauge. So the idea behind this, so the go side should go in with no trouble all the way through the thread if it's a through hole. And the no go side should go in no more than three turns, okay, or three threads. So there we go, barely half a turn. That's as far as it'll go. So you can say that thread is a thin specification. Now, the thread also has to be located. Now, if there's a minor diameter note under the feature control frame, that indicates that you can use the minor diameter to locate the thread. So you can use the largest gauge pin that'll fit through that thread. If there is no minor diameter note, you have to simulate the pitch cylinder of the thread. Now you need a special tool for that. It's a precision thread with a pin on it so that you can capture that pitch cylinder, because that's what more accurately locates the thread. For some applications, it doesn't matter as much, and for inspection, it's certainly easier if you have that minor diameter symbol to inspect. So we choose the largest gauge pin that'll fit through the thread. Now, we do need to record the size of the gauge pin so we can subtract half of it from our measured location, but we're not gonna have any, there's not gonna be any bonus tolerance with this. Now, there's an argument to be made for using or for not using bonus tolerances on threads. I would say it's not generally very useful, because if you go look in the thread standard, there's very, very little tolerance on threads, okay? Very little. So even if you could measure that the thread left MMC toward LMC, it'd only be like tenths of thousandths of inches, and it's very difficult to apply that to the actual location of the thread. So I'd recommend just leave threads RFS. Because of the way you inspect them, the MMC is rarely going to be very useful, okay? So we got our gauge pin in here. Why don't we go ahead and get the location of this feature? We'll do it similar to before. We're gonna set up to A, B on our angle plate, And in this case, C doesn't matter because it's only controlling location. I can clamp my part in. I'll zero off of my angle plate. When we're using the indicator to find the location of our gauge pin, we want to get as close to the part as we can, and we're gonna move it back and forth. We want the needle to hit zero at the top of its run. If it goes past zero, you need to readjust so that it doesn't. So what's happening is, as the needle is going down one side of the pin, the indicator is dropping, so the needle's moving counterclockwise. As the indicator moves to the top of the pin, it rises to zero, and then it starts going back down again, it goes back down. Okay, so as long as it's touching zero, that is the actual location. So in this case, we've got 6.995. So I'm gonna write that down, and I'll punch it into a Excel calculator later on. Our gauge pin diameter is 0.314. I'm gonna write that down as well. So we've got our X location, or I'm sorry, our Y location. Now we're gonna get our X location. Similar setup, A, B, C, okay? I'm gonna clamp this in. As close to the middle part, portion of the part as I can. I'll have to move this clamp out of the way a little bit. So now I gotta zero my indicator to the table. Zero. Bring it back up, and I'll do the exact same thing I did before. And I've got X 1.0965 on my height gauge. I got a zero on my indicator. That's gonna be our location for that feature. Now on the screen, I'll punch it in the Excel calculator and show you what it should be. I did some quick calculations by hand here. They're not more than 2/1000ths out in either direction. So you could say this part is good without even figuring it out, finding the diameter of positional variation. The reason is that when you have a 14/1000ths diameter tolerance zone, you can look this up on a table. It essentially means you have 3.5/1000ths in either direction from the true position. As long as your X and Ys are less than that, there's a really good chance the part is good. So I drew a little figure here. Your X and Y coordinates, as long as it falls within that 7/1000ths, you don't really have to check to see if it's in any of this diameter tolerance zone, okay? Now, you should, because the Excel spreadsheet is pretty easy to do, but even before you go figure that out, you can just see the numbers. I think I got one is out by 1.5/1000ths. That would be totally fine, because it's gonna fall within this square that you can figure out with arithmetic. Whereas if one came in at 4/1000ths in one direction, now it's outside of this little square, and you gotta figure out if it falls within the area between the square and the circle that surrounds the square, okay? So that's it for this video. Just wanna talk a little bit more about inspection and kinda why we do it certain ways. The datum reference frame is really important. You wanna make sure that is good. Profile tolerances don't have to be checked with the optical comparator every time. Especially if they're flat surfaces, you can do it all on the plate, okay? So if you enjoyed the video, please like, subscribe, comment down below, and I'll make more of these at the surface plate coming pretty soon.